Yo, Ice. The organization say they can't stay in business with us any longer. What are you gonna do?
We always knew we were gonna come to this point sooner or later. We have absolutely no option but to move forward. We'll have to set up our own distribution, manufacturing, run a totally independent organization and operation.
Hey, things a little slow since Warner put you down.
You guys look kind of broke. How about a lift?
I was born in New Jersey. I said it before, but I guess nobody heard me. My mother died young. No sisters or brothers. I was the only son. When I was 12, my pops died too. What's a brother supposed to do? They sent me out west to live with my aunt. I guess they thought that was the best. But there was no love there. But growing with no moms, I guess I was prepared to live in a vacuum. The bedroom, the kitchen, the hall, the bathroom. I didn't leave home much. Didn't like LA. Didn't have no friends to trust. Got bused to a school. Blacks and whites, I guess the shit was cool. But by high school I changed. Didn't want to bust, didn't want to play the game. I walked to Crenshaw High. Shit was fly.
Hey.
Hello.
You filming?
Yeah, we're filming. Is that okay?
Let's go. Yeah. Look at that.
What's that? Wow.
It's a 3600 watt custom car stereo. And I'm the guitar player for Body Count. We're all one big happy syndicate family.
So when's that record gonna be done?
What record?
The HL.
Oh, it's done.
That's how I'm living. I did 3 years in and made close friends. Having no love, my homies became my only. I was glad, the family I never had. But I grew up fast.
Okay.
Got a girl in the 10th grade pregnant.
So when was the house built?
Huh?
When was the house built?
Oh, this house is about 2 years old. We bought it from a doctor. He had built it, but never lived in it.
So who designed the house?
I don't know.
Who made your...
The interior.
Yeah.
Me, you know. I basically... like kind of, you know, like modern type furnishings and things like that, try to keep everything simple. So I'm not a interior decorator, but I know if you do everything in black and white, then everything matches that you put in the house, right?
So this is,
so this is like a stereo place where I got all kind of stuff. This is cool. Watch this, turn around, look up there.
What's that?
This is a screen, look at this.
Wow.
And this projector over your head. This is the spoils of war.
So what is that supposed to mean?
Oh, the spoils of war, it's kind of like, after all the battles people have been seeing me go through, there's gotta be something good behind it, you know what I'm saying? So this is, you know, this house right here and the things I got in it, I've been doing records for like 6 years and stuff, so I've accumulated a few little things and stuff. But it's funny, because people come and see my house, like, oh, yeah, you're making all this money. I'm like, well, come on, be serious. Few dollars I made is nothing compared to what they've made, you know, off of me. I was in the movie New Jack City.
Mm-hmm.
I made $28,000. The movie made $60 million. And here's my fish tank. I got eels in there. I have lionfish that eat goldfish and stuff, so.
And the table's kind of special, it seems.
Yeah, all the stuff I had, I found, it's kind of like ice. It looked like ice to me, like sculpted ice. So, I was in this place and the guy was like, I can make you a table. I saw a coffee table like this and he said he could make it and he made it for me. So it's like a one of a kind and it matches the little table over there. So coming down here, this is another Ricochet, New Jack City. So when I do some more films, I don't know, maybe I have to get a longer wall. Coming into my, it's like my den. We start in the living room and as you can see, I'm into all kinds of weird stuff. Like these are the guy from Hellraiser. Guy back there's the cop killer off of the album Body Count.
Cop killer!
Yeah! I got people that make these things and I paint them. So like one of my hobbies. And then this is my kitchen. And I got, as you can see, I got Punisher pictures up on the wall to help me cook. Picture me and my dog. It's like a very interesting lifestyle. It's like you got hardcore iced tea, right? Right next to them you got like Tasmanian devils and then comic books. And then this is the worst place to be in the house. See these fish?
Yeah.
These are the fish that are gonna get fed to the other fish. So these fish right here, they're not in for a good night. This is a picture of Little Ice when he was real little, with his hat on.
How old is he now?
1 and a half.
Where is he now?
Out someplace, probably driving at a party, hanging out, robbing a store or something, I don't know.
What kind of a father are you? I'm curious to know.
Hey, I mean, I got a daughter right now who's like just went into high school, and I had her when I was in high school. I was in the 12th grade, and I just try to be a friend, you know? I mean, I don't lie about my past tour, and I try to just, I think the main thing with parenting is communication. I think the key is to keep an open line of communication. Now, she knows I was bad. She knows I was in a gang. She knows I used to rob. She knows I've been to jail. She knows that. Doesn't mean that I want her to do that. She knows her uncles and all my friends is bad guys. A lot of them are still locked up. A lot of the guys that she remembers when she was little, she'll never see again because they're dead, you know? So
dead how?
They got killed out in the streets, you know, hustling, doing crimes. So I try to guide her. You know, she wants to be an entertainer. She, like, wants to sing. I'm saying, why don't you be an entertainment lawyer? You know, I'm a regular parent, I guess. You know, why don't you go for the law?
Is that so? Yeah?
Me and her.
Why would you prefer that about her being an entertainer?
Because anybody who... Why would anybody want to get into a business where statistically it's impossible to be a success? You know, this is a dream. I'm very fortunate and lucky. But I can honestly say, and I'm not saying this egotistically, but you could interview 8 out of 10 musicians haven't been even able to obtain the little stuff that I got. You know, this might look grand to people. I mean, I'm just saying, on the scale of what's available on somebody like Michael Jackson, this is like about the size of Michael Jackson's closet, probably. Always go for something that's guaranteed, like a job, and then pursue your dream at the same time. But see, I didn't have anything really to fall back on with this. If I hadn't have made it like this, I would have been back out in the streets.
Too many years I've seen my brothers die. And I can't say that it was really that fly, but I used to gang bang when I was younger. So it's really hard to tell a kid that he's going under.
Right now we're working on a new Body Count album. The album's called Born Dead. And we're just working on it, and it's good, and I hope people like it again, you know.
Why is it called Born Dead?
Well, it's a kind of a song about, this title song, Born Dead, is just saying that, you know, being poor, being black, or being on the downside of the American system, you're not even expected to live past the age of 21. You know, if you stay here, I'm gonna show you something. Let me run over here right quick, and I'll bring something back to you.
Please, yeah.
It's a plate. And it says, commemorating every black man who lives to see 21.
Who made that?
A lady sent it to me, one of my fans. And it's interesting, you know, it's kind of, to think that somebody would even make this plate, it's like a way of saying, hey, you guys are like born dead. It's like you're born, your life expectancy is so limited. And it's sad, and this is the plate gave me the idea for this album.
I've been sitting home trying to understand why a motherfucker can't get justice in America. 20 cops in the street, 2 go to jail. That don't add up to me. I didn't even go to college, you know what I'm saying? So I came up with this conclusion.
Born dead stuff.
Born yellow. Born brown. Born red. Born black.
out yet.
No, that's not out. This is just a demo. You know, we're just messing around in recording studio, coming up with ideas.
Dead. Dead.
Break.
London. Los Angeles. Chicago. New York.
Stuff. Nobody ain't never heard this.
That's George right there. He's making all the decisions.
He's your manager?
Yeah. Manager, business partner, gardener, all in one.
Gardener too?
Yeah. He's outside. Manicurist.
So I'm gonna go trim those bushes in the front.
Right.
How did Warner communicate with you when they had to tell you that they couldn't release your next record?
Well, the record was prepared to go. It was in the cover, and everything was done, and I was out on tour with Body Count, and I got this phone call that was like, Body Count ain't coming out on Warner Brothers because they don't like the album cover. I was like, I mean Ice-T's album, your new album, Home Invasion, won't come out, and I was like, what are you talking about? I'm like, it's the cover? What don't they like? And George was like, well, what do they like? I was like, I'm like, well, just give me a black album cover or something. Let's just go. You know, I wanted the record to come out.
Mm-hmm.
Then I came home and I just started thinking about it. And I just wrote him a letter and I was like.
Hey, this who?
Who?
Who did you write a letter?
To Warner Brothers, to Mo Austin, people up there.
Yeah.
And I was like, look, I am aware that you guys aren't the ones censoring me. It's coming in from higher up.
You think so?
Yeah, I know so.
Like where from?
Time in the corporate area, up high, way above the record label level. Because the record label had already approved the album and was pressed and it was ready to go. Mm. So somebody else called in. And I just said, look, you know, you can't seriously ask me to change this and change that and expect for me to feel comfortable. You know, I'm not going to jeopardize my integrity. Why don't you just let me go? You know, let me go. I'll be all right. And I'll do it myself.
Is it true that there was pressure from the unions of police officers?
Well, that was when Cop Killer was out. There was pressure from them to pull the record. But that pressure was off. They were predicting new pressures if they had dropped this album. They weren't worrying about any pressures at the time. But it's okay, you know what I'm saying? I'm like I say, in the end, it's a blessing in disguise because now I'm running my own business and I much prefer this than being signed.
But from now on, if any cops get in our way,
one of the tracks the record opens with is the track where you say, from now on, if any cops get in our way, and then you go,
right.
Well, it sounds good, but it sounds also a little theatrical to
me. That's what it is. It's theatrics. It's just a way of this saying, it's a way of us saying that if from now on, there will be no retreats. If the cops get involved and they want to make some noise, then we'll make some noise with them. We're not pulling any records, you know. Now, whether we're physically going to get out there and shoot them, I don't know. But maybe, you know, if you're an Ice-T fan, you want to believe Ice-T will do that. You know, that's part of the luxury of being in a chair or some headphones on listening to it. But a lot of hardcore rap is theatrical, you know. It's us playing the parts of somebody, so.
I think a lot of people also take rap very literal and think it's all, you know.
Well, I don't care. I don't think there's any problem if they think it literal as long as they don't go out and try to reenact the stuff they hear on the records, you know. There's people that think wrestling is real on TV. There's people that think that there's really a Terminator. There's a lot of people that are mentally incapable of understanding films and music. They really got shot in that movie. Whatever, but I think most people know. And there's never been any proof that this music leads to violence or harm to anybody, so I don't even entertain those worries people have. Oh, this record's gonna make someone prove it.
How many bullets can your back hold, sucker, from the HK? The red dots in your dome from the light ray. Boom, bam, bust. Oh, damn, kid, your head is a pile of pus. I'm kicking a much dust. The brother you can't trust. This is my hood, my goal, my turf, my stash, my grip, whatever the hell it's worth. I don't need nobody coming in my territory trying to rip a brother off and kill a damn top story.
Take a good look, see I'm nothing but a jacker, about to fill the rap up a greedy ass cracker. Now let's know, so you know the punk stand out. Coming in my hood with his hand out, trying to get over on the black, but the Goldie Mac, I put a damn slug in his back. And with the boom, ping, ping, it ain't no thing to blast. I'm greedy little suckers that trespass.
So I understand you also have a weapon collection.
Yeah, I got weapon collections. I like weapons. It's interesting, right? Because I just got finished doing interviews with Britain, and they come on the phone. They're like, "Well, do you think it's right for you to show your guns on TV?" And I'm like, I said, "But every time a camera crew comes here from Europe, they're like, show us the guns, show us the guns." So then what happens is, I end up looking like I'm showing guns off when I didn't really, they're locked up someplace right now. So I'm not gonna show
you. You're not gonna show them.
See, because what happens is, then people think, well, I wanna show you the guns. So you have to beg me or something, but I'm not gonna do it anyhow. Here goes a nifty little tool, an Australian gun. It's called a Glock. And what makes this one so cool, has a laser. Look into the camera right here. You like about that there, eh? That looks cool, don't it? And wherever that dot goes, the old bullet Torino follows. So these are some nifty little things you pick up on the way home from, you know, shopping. Glock.
But you need a license for that, don't you?
Well, no, when you buy the gun, you have to go through a period of time where they check you out and see if you, you know, got warrants or wanted by the police. Then they won't sell it to you. So it takes 15 days. But once they, but you fill out 100 pages paper, and then once they give it to you, you're the registered owner to it. And that goes to Sacramento or wherever they want monitoring.
So what about you? I mean, you
as far as a license, no. No, as far as me buying the guns, most of the times when I get them, I'll get them through my girlfriend, you know, Darlene. She buys them, so most of the guns are registered to her.
Because you wouldn't be able to get one registered on your name.
I don't know. I don't know if we want to discuss that. But, you know, I get them. But they're legal, you know what I'm saying? You can't get a license to carry one. See, the trick is you can't carry one on the streets. If you had to move this gun, you'd have to put it in the back trunk of your car. Or either have it in your car and the bullet's in the trunk. You can't roll with a gun loaded. But everybody does because you know, America.
But is it just a toy for you? Because you're not really gonna use them, I assume.
Well, no, I go to the range and I shoot it, so that makes it a toy, I guess. And I got here to protect my house and stuff, but no, it's kind of just like toys and pieces of art, you know, things, you know, put on the wall. Ooh, a machine of murder. This record by Jimi Hendrix.
What did you say?
It's Jimi Hendrix, but it's me singing.
Vision, where you going with that gun in your hand?
I ain't no singer, but I can fake it. Where you going?
Going out to shoot my old lady. You know I caught her messing around with another man. Going out to shoot my old lady.
We can put this out if we decide to go pop. Good solo in here.
Heard you say-
sound all right, huh? Sing it. Yes, I did. I shot her.
You know, I caught that girl messing around town.
I got my gun and I shot her.
I'm making a joke. You know, I said, do this when we go pop. You know, so yeah. We decided to go pop. Because everybody's like, yeah, you guys should do something that's radio playable and you could be huge, you know? I mean, I've been hearing this for years.
Is that so?
But I just don't like to.
KLOS. 17 minutes after 9, Mark and Brian show. Chris Isaac is here.
Yes, he is. Now,
with his buddy drummer extraordinaire, Kenny Dale Johnson.
You're too kind.
Hey. This is kind of interesting as we take a look at your bio. You were attending college in Japan, fighting on an amateur boxing team.
Sure you were, Chris.
And working as a film studio tour guide when you decided to do the singing thing.
Yeah, well, the boxing was like, that was nowhere. I got all the cartilage taken out of my nose from doing that. Mm-hmm. And the tour guide stuff was like, that doesn't pay any kind of money.
Mm-hmm.
And you had to get up early for both kinds of those things, you know, get up early and train. I thought, hey. Mm-hmm. I know who's sleeping in late.
Those musicians out of Hollywood. How they gonna do that?
So please, forgive me. Y hasta en la tumba te sigo amando. Si quieres.
Very nice.
Very nice, man.
What was that song?
La tumba será el final, which that means in Spanish, Kenny?
The dike's flooding. No?
No, doesn't mean that.
No.
Work on your Spanish.
Oh. What, whose song is it?
Well, we heard it's a...
I think it's a traditional song, actually.
I think it's ZZ Top. This is what we think is the next kind of big craze in music. You know, there's been a lot of rap and there's been a lot of house music came and went, really. Mm. But this, I think, is the next big thing. It's kind of a hukilau music.
Sweet Leilani, hey, heavenly flower, I dreamt of paradise for.